Stephen O'Donnell's art always seems poised to tell a story that's happening just beyond the frame, through an open doorway, within an obscure look or gesture. In putting together the Untold Gaze, we wanted to see what happened if those stories were given voice. We asked 33 writers to each pick a painting and use it as inspiration for a piece of original fiction. What we got was a collection of stories beyond anything we could have imagined, the subjects ranging from amorous satyrs to beauty pageant queens to post-apocalyptic alien overlords, written by some of our favorite writers in Portland and beyond. If you are a writer in this book, raise your hand. A huge thank you to Portland Book Festival for inviting us to do this pop-up. One of the things we're extra excited about is that our pop-up is happening here in front of, pretty close to, this beautiful boucher. That's this one over there. Which is one of Stephen's favorite paintings in the Art Museum. His earliest work was inspired by 18th century portraiture like this, and throughout his career, it's continued to inspire much of his work, including many of the paintings in the book. Oh, hand me a book. I'm gonna show the picture.
Sorry.
All right, I have. I want to show off a particular painting, which is of that time period. And that is, oops. And I just lost my page. There it is. This is Le Repos, which was used as the inspiration for Laura Stanfill's story, All This. Laura Stanfill is a writer and publisher of the powerhouse Portland Small Press, Forest Avenue Press. Laura is the most creative, most driven, most hardworking person I know. She has a singular talent for creating community and supporting writers everywhere. Check out the Forest Avenue Press booth in the Fields Ballroom where they're sharing a table with Perfect Day Books. Laura.
All this. A fine place to rest. This salon, empty of courtesy and calling cards. They urge me here every afternoon. They say, you must be tired. They say, do not trouble yourself with that. They say, your daughter has already chosen the linens for this evening. And if I refuse to hide myself because someone charmant is about to arrive, they say, asseyez-vous, remember your hips, as if I have been dancing in the foyer instead of standing, as if standing might ruin me, as if a visitor might say the wrong thing to the right people about the audacity of my red shoes and ruin us. And so I go upstairs when they tell me to go. No one here to disturb the light. No heels clicking on this floor. I sit with a warm measure of silence on my lap. Our grand old parrot keeps one eye on the horizon, one eye on my nose. He's suspicious because they whisper stories about me into his beak, not his ears, because no one can find his ears. And he listens with his tongue, and he agrees with what they say. Even though years ago, I picked out his perch and leather tether, and I hired the man who trained him to repeat the surnames of the best families in town, and to sing the first jolly few bars of Marlborough Salva Tonguer. Now this parrot only opens its beak to listen. The best old names must still be caged inside, caged in his bird brain, only occasionally leaking out his ears when I get too tired to watch him watch my nose. And the moment I forget to watch, those names plink out of his ears like marbles and click on the floor, and I open my eyes hoping to see somebody seeking my company. Only no one is there. Perhaps It is not about my shoes. I close my eyes until the silence pushes back its stilled curtains and becomes interesting. The strain of wind over land, the scratch of leaves blown onto the balcony, the snuffled breaths of this fine spaniel, trained not to bark, a warm dog-shaped silence in my lap, her ribs moving fast with dreams of chasing. I have heard them laughing about how no one ever taught me not to bark. Perhaps tomorrow I shall not argue when they urge me upstairs, demain, lest I say something inexplicable or forget to remove a glove, or worse, don the wrong glove for the wrong occasion. Perhaps tomorrow when they send me away from the daily household doings that used to be my doings, my hands will undo this fichu from around my neck. My fine red shoes will tap a loud rigadon across this floor, and my cap will drop onto the brass tray reserved for calling cards for people who are not calling for me, not anymore. And after I unknot this grand old parrot's tether, he will accompany me to the balcony, singing of all the people who used to matter. And I will gather those surnames in my skirts, heave my legs and hips over the balustrade, careful not to drop any syllables, and give all this to the wind.
Rien n'égale.